Praise to Allah, we have been graced by the chance to gather in this momentous program. Before we move on, let us begin with the recitation of dua that will be led by Muhammad Daniel Najmuddin bin Mahmud.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
نسألك يا من هو الله الذي لا إله إلا هو الرحمن الرحيم الملك القدوس السلام المؤمن المهيمن العزيز الجبار المتكبر الخالق البارئ القهار الوهاب الرزاق الفتاح العليم القابض الباسط الخافي الرافع المعز المذل السميع البصير الحكم العليم اللطيف الخبير العليم العظيم الغفور الشكور العلي الكبير الحفيظ المقيت الحسيب الجليل الكريم الرقيب المجيب الواسع الحكيم الودود المجيد الباعث الشهيد الحق الوكيل القوي المتين الولي الحميد المحسي المبدع المعيد المحيي المميت الحي القيوم الواجد الماجد الواحد الصمد القادر المقتدر المقدم المؤخر الأول الآخر الظاهر الباطن الوالي المتعالي البار التواب المنتكم العفو رؤوف مالك الملك ذو الجلال والإكرام المقصي الجامع الغني المغني المانع الضار النافع النور الهادي البديع الباقي الوارث الرشيد الصبور الذي ليس كمثله شيء وهو السميع البصير اللهم صل أفضل الصلاة على أسعد المخلوقات كسيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم عدد معلوم ماتك ومداد كلماتك كلما ذكرك الذاكرون وغفل عن ذكره
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين يا الله يا رحمن الرحيم سنبني kami berjumpa pada hari ini bagi menyampaikan kesyukuran di atas kenyataan yang tidak senilai jadi kerana kami hamba-hambanya yang sentiasa bersyukur sama ada nilai yang sedikit lebih-lebih lagi nak yang limpah Allah kepada kami ya Allah. Sebenarnya Engkau Maha Mengetahui bahawa kami di sini ingin menimba ilmu-Mu yang sangat luas bagi mengembangkan praktisi kami secara hamba-Mu yang Engkau tadi. Jika berkati dan rahmatilah perintah kami, tindakanlah kepada kami apa kiranya ilmu-Mu, sinarilah hati-hati kami dengan cahaya dan hidayah-Mu. Semoga dengannya kami mudah menjadinya dan memiliki serta amalannya. Sobana asina sidina hasana wa sidaya kiasana. Asyina azalana wa sallahu alaihi wa sallam wa sallam wa alhamdulillah.
Amin amin ya rabbal alamin. Thank you to Muhammad Ali Najmuddin bin Mahmud for the recitation of Dua just now. The program will be continued with a brief video of the panel's background. Moving on to the first law, which is investment talk, sustainable investing, a future of ESG stock. I welcome Dr. Nor Ashiki Miti Ismail, a lecturer of finance, UITM Johor, to deliver her insight.
Okay, assalamualaikum, and I'm very thankful to Iklima as MC for this program. Okay, let me share my screens. Okay, bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Rabbi syrahli sadri wa yassirli amri wahlul 'uqdatam min lisani yafqahu qawli. Okay, today what I'm going to talk is my topic on is something to do with ESG stocks. Okay, can you see my slide right now?
Yes, madam.
Yep, okay. Hold on. Okay, my topic for today's speech is will be on the sustainable investing, a future of ESG stocks. Okay, have you heard about ESG? Any ideas on ESG? Okay, I'm sure that some of you might be quite curious what is ESG is all about. Okay, today I'm going to talk about the ESG stock or ESG environment, social governance factors of stocks. Okay. Okay, let me give some idea what I'm going to talk for today. Okay, these are the outlines of my presentation. Basically, I will give some ideas on the concept of sustainable investing, our motivations of the sustainable, and then will be some ideas on the global growth of sustainable investing. And then there will be what is ESG, and then it will be ESG security, and then the last part will be on the future prospects. So this is actually all is actually something to do with the environmental social governance, or sometimes they call it sustainable investing. I think that is more proper. Okay, before we go in detail, let's have a look on the concept. Okay, when we say investment, sustainable investing, basically what we are talking about is an investment discipline that whereby they are considering the environmental, social and corporate governance criteria. So basically that particular company have conducted ESG practice. So meaning to say that you as an investors, if you are interested on the company that participate or engage in ESG, so what you do is you will see that because they have specific index, which is actually FTSE4Good index, Bursa Malaysia. Okay, later on we will see some. So in the earlier part, I will show to you what does sustainable investing is all about. So basically, this one is actually consists of environmental, social, governance criteria, whereby with the intentions of to generate long-term financial returns and positive society impact. So sometimes, okay, this concept is actually, sometimes they call it ethical investing. So previously, there have a lot of studies have been done on ethical investing. And not only that, they have a social responsibility investing. So this is actually another interesting topic on finance. People are talking about SRI. And later, they have improved on that, is extension for this SRI. So they have a value-based investing. We are very famous with a very, very famous so that is ESG, or we call it environmental, social, and governance investing. So meaning to say that sustainable investments, we are referring to environmental, social investing, or we call it ESG. So we are talking about ESG stocks, okay? So that's why in my presentations, I see that my title was on future of ESG. So I'll give some idea what is ESG is all about. Okay, not only that, there was, this concept of ESG appeared it started in 2001. And again, there was a very, very famous principle in accounting, they call it triple bottom line, 3BL. So this is actually an accounting framework that consider environmental social impact along with the traditional profit. Okay, we are very familiar with the financial ratio or financial information, right, that we can see from the annual report. But nowadays, people are also concerned on the non-financial information. So that non-financial information is actually, we are talking about environmental, socials, and governance. So this is actually become an hot issue, especially in the era of the sustainable finance, and we are now moving towards to have a zero carbon emission, all those things. So basically, this is something to do with the climate change. Because if you look at the environment, it's something to do with climate change issues. So that's why people are moving towards on this particular matters, ESG. Okay. So if you look at this diagram, so wait, can you hear me? Am I going too fast? I hope I'm not going too fast. Okay, because I was told that this program is in YouTube, so that's why I couldn't get some feedbacks. Okay, this is actually triple bottom line. So this is what I mean by the accounting flow. So as you can see here, they have three components. Okay, the first component is actually economic performance. So this is actually what they have, we were looking at the profit. And then we also have the social performance, talking about the human relationships with the community. This is, and then we have the environmental performance. So all these three is actually, you can come up with the sustainability performance. So in fact, we have a very famous concept that is called corporate sustainability performance that consists of the environmental, socials, and along the way with the governance. So, and this is actually is very famous and become famous topic now, especially when we talk about ESG factors. Okay, let us look at why we are so concerned. What are the driver of the, what are the motivations that you want to go for sustainable investing? So first of all, is actually from the investment success itself. So as you can see here, is actually the first motivations is actually investment success. So it was found that investment in ESG have performed or very outperformed with lower volatility than the peers. Peers means that there will be other indexes that not considering the ESG with by 28.67%. And not only that, it was like giving some positive impact on the equity returns by 6.12%. So this is actually to, based on the 2020 trends reports, sustainable and responsible investment. Okay, invested, the second topic will be investor demand. So the second one is actually, the second motivation is investor demand. Okay, this one, as you can see that now, as I mentioned, people are going for companies that considering that taking into consideration the environmental issues, which is talking about the climate change, pollutions, all these things. And not only that, they also concerns on the society, social factors. So that things have been, there's an increasing demand for both retail and institutional investors, because they know that if they go and invested in these particular stocks, they can obtain a very good return. And there's a few studies have been done on that showing the ESG performance or sustainable prosper for investing with the financial promoter that looking from the shareholders perspective. So you are now moving towards that. So in that particular, it will encourage more company to participate in terms of ESG, because this one is actually coming from the retail and institutional investors, whereby they know that if their company are going to get involved, they can obtain a positive returns. So this is actually from the side of the investor itself. Okay, and then we go to the next one, which is actually the next point will be public policy and legislations. So basically here is actually House Democrat introduced a sustainable investment policy that require large asset investment in section in making it. Okay, in a way that we also in Malaysia, we have a sustainable sustainable responsible investment plan, whereby they considering that having to concentrate on the executive factor in terms of investment decision. And the last one is actually on the downside protection. So we know that by having the ESG investing, it can provide a protection investment, especially during the social and economic crisis. So these are the four motivation factors that allow that sustainable investors should go forwards. Okay, now we go to the next one, which is on the global. Okay, let us see that global growth of sustainable investing. So if you look at here, okay, later on I'll show you the some of the the graph, the line, the chart that shows the how's the performance of the such to be investing. Okay, basically Europe and United States are the biggest market players in the sustainable investing. And again, we know that they got from the Paris Agreement, now people, a lot of company are trying to go for the carbon emission zero, carbon emissions, and it's like they are doing commoditizations. And this is actually showing that there's a well ahead of the sustainable curve and the specific legislation is shaping. So this is actually from the, and then when we look at a specific country in Asia, we can see that from 2016 to 2018, the largest increase was in Japan, whereby there are proportions of sustainable asset grew over the 30%. And not only that, in United States itself, you can see there's also another growth slightly, even though it was not as much as those in Japan, but it still got a slightly higher, which is it moved from the 33% to 38%. So at the end of the day, what you can see that there was an arise of sustainable investing in a global phenomena and reaching a myriad of industry. So let me show you the okay, can you see here? Wait, okay, this is actually is a comparison between 2012 in sustainable investing, which is actually as compared to. So if you look at here, we have about five countries. So as you can see, Japan, they have about 0.01, and the largest here is actually more on the Europe market. So whereby they have about 8.8 trillion. So that was in 2012. And at that time, as you can see in the graph, in the pie chart here, the total of the sustainable investing was 13.3 trillion. But this number have jumped to 30.7 trillion. So, and as you can see that the most significant growth was in US market, because US in 2012 it was only 3.7 trillion, but however when it goes jump to 2018, you can see that the number go jump about 3.7 to 12 trillion, which is a nearly about 400% or 350% increment. But when you look at Euro market, still there's an increase from 8.8 trillion to 14. And not to forget, we in Asia, we have also Japan. Japan also shows a very good improvement in this impressive punya growth, whereby as you can see that from 0.01 trillion, it goes to 2.23 trillion. So this is actually showing that Japan have showing a very increment of sustainable asset by nearly impressive near 200 fold. So not only again, you can also see that the Canada, Australia, it goes the same. There was an increase on that. Okay, now we'll look at the next. Okay, I'm so sorry because my laptop quite loose. Okay, now look at the US market, because we can see just now there was like about 350 in growth in US. Remember from the 3 point something, it was goes to about 12. So let's look at the on the sustainable in the US per se from the 1995 to 2000. So as you can see here, they got ESG corporation, meaning to say that the company that incorporated the environmental, social, and so it was like there was an increment. The blue color was talking about ESG corporation, meaning to they have a lot of company have incorporate or integrate the ESG factors. So, and not only that, we also have a shareholder. So this is actually there was the blue color showing there was a very, very impressive growth for the sustainable investing looking from the ESG corporations company. Okay. Okay, these are the some of the company that we see that the most sustainable corporation. Okay, the first one was actually on the Hansen Bioscience Industry, that was from Denmark. So what happened is that they have put some ESGF in terms of 100% green operation commitment in April 2020. And then we have about 18% revenue actually directly from support. So this is actually from the Denmark. And then we also have from the US market, which we Autodesk. So they also have 100% renewable energy and services offices. And we as you can see that when we talk about women here, is this one is actually something to do with the corporate governance in terms of the board of director. Whether is there any more participation from women's side? So there was like about 44% women are on the board. And then in Braco Brazil Finance, which is on the Brazil. So they also have a green economy spending 551 million. And the last one is actually, this is the most sustainable, top most sustainable corporation globally. And the last one is actually on the city development real estate is in Singapore. So they also have issued a very 100 millions of green fort, green bond. Okay, green bond is actually, okay, remember sometimes the what you call that saving investment is sometimes it can quoted as a green investing. So they have a lot of many commentants on the investing on that. Okay, and in fact, by 2030, Singapore is actually trying to get a 59 carbon emission reductions. That is a big target. And now, if you look in Europe market, they are now moving toward electric car vehicles. So that is actually one of the initiatives trying to get away from the pollution and gas emissions. Okay, so this is actually the most sustainable corporations. Okay, now we look at it. Now you have an idea what is sustainable investing. Okay, as I mentioned earlier, this is something to do with ESG. Okay, let's have a look what is at ESG. Okay, any questions if you have? Or maybe I should go proceed with the presentations. Am I right, Ikmi? Iklima, am I right? I go just for presentation. The Q&A session will be in the last sessions.
Yes, madam.
Okay. So because I'm afraid because it looks in my Gmail it was only 7, but I was told that it was a YouTube sessions. I mean YouTube live. Okay, what is ESG? Okay, ESG is actually, as I mentioned, environmental, social, and governance. So environment here is actually when we saw environment factors, it consists of it's something to do with a climate change, natural resources, pollutions, waste, and biodiversity. So that is actually the first element in the ESG. Okay, and then we have the social. So this is actually more on the human rights. And then not only that, sometimes they also include the, it consists of supply chain standard, labor management, health and safety, human capital development. So this particular, dimension actually represent the social factors. And the last one is actually on governance. So the governance here is actually, we are talking about the corporate governance. And basically, we are looking at the, there's an elements of executive pay, board diversity. That's why we have about diversity just now. We got one of the companies actually, they also have a more participation of the women in US. Remember, they were about 44%. And we also have the business ethics under governance. Okay, let's look at the detail on that. Okay, environmental factors. Okay, when we say environmental factors, basically what we are trying to look at, what are we going to consider would be, is a company that perform as a steward nature. So basically under the environmental investing, what kind of, what is the components that included in this? So basically we are talking about the biodiversity, carbon emission, and this is coming as very hot issue, especially on transport sector regarding the the green vehicles. And then we have a type of energy use, we have a waste management, water pollution, and treatment of animal. So these are all these areas that being covered under environmental components. And then we look at the social social factors. Okay, when we look at the social factors here, so basically what we can see that these factors is looking at, the company is looking on the internal and external business relationship. So for that, what they're going to look at under social factors, they're trying to look in terms of community relation. So meaning to say that this is actually how is the community between the company in the society per se. How they communicate, is there any CSR being done on that? So this is actually is something to do corporate social responsibility, CSR. Previously, we can see that most of the company actually are involving with CSR. And that particular part is actually coming from that social factors whereby, and then not only that, we are also very concerned on the customer satisfactions. Because at the end of the day, customer is the one which you bring a business. So that's why this particular area must be taken into social into the social factors or elements. And then we have data protections. Then we have privacy, and we have employee diversity, employee engagements, human rights records and labor practice. And as we can see here, basically the social criteria or social factor is trying to look how we manage our relationship with employees, suppliers, customer and community. So basically this is talking about the company engagement with the stakeholders. Because when we talk about stakeholders here, we are talking about the employees. We're not only talking about the shareholders. We are talking about when we talk about the stakeholders theory, it consists of a lot of users here. It consists of employees, suppliers, customers, community, regulator. Policy maker, shareholders. So these are all the things. So basically, they have to look at in a wider picture rather than on a specific of the shareholders. And then we have the last one is on the governance factors. Okay, when we say about governance here, basically we are talking about the company corporate governance. Okay, pernah dengar corporate governance? I'm sure that most of you have not talked about, very familiar on this one. And not only that, what you can see here is actually what things that been covered under corporate governance. It will be on the boardroom diversity, audit practice, executive compensations, employees compensations, corruptive practice, and present of whistleblower scheme. So at the end of the day, what the governance is trying to look is, they are trying to look at the company leadership, which is actually on the board composition. Okay, this is actually the one that relating by the woman, not only social, sorry. That was a error, just not, when we talk about the woman, we are talking about the governance factors and alignment with stakeholders and shareholders and stakeholders' rights, okay? So these are all the, okay, this is actually what ESG is all about, okay? Okay, now we move to the next one. Let me show you some idea in the pictures. So again, when people talk about ESG jobs, so meaning to say that particular company have engaged. When we say the ESG stock, what I mean by that? So you means that company that stocks where you, when you go and invest and this particular stock or this particular, they get engaged, they are participate in the environmental, social and governance. So I guess here you say that this, okay, at the end of the things is actually, you know that the three component here is actually the environmental, social and governance is actually represent on how to evaluate the company's sustainable performance. And in fact, I have done one studies on one research regarding the corporate sustainability. It was very interesting because I was doing on the comparisons on the corporate sustainability performance, the ESG, towards the financial performance, looking from the two Asian countries, which is Malaysia and Indonesia. And it was like, if the company get involved more on the ESG, or they get more participate on the environmental, social and governance, they tend to have a very high financial return on equity. So in a way that you can see that is why we can see that the investors are now are moving towards to the ESG stock. Later we'll see that some performance indicator. Okay, now okay, again there are a lot of credit rating provider have their own ESG criteria. Okay, I'm only take the top three punya rating provider from Thomson's, MSCI and Bloomberg. So again, different provider, they have different different definition, different criteria from the three pillars, environmental, socials. So if you look at the Tom's cake here, I'm just sharing with you the three top rating, the top three rating provider regarding ESG lah. So basically, the first environment pillar was environmental factors. So as you can see here, that from the Thomson itself, so when they say the environmental, resource use, emission and innovation. And in fact, if you are interested to do some studies on the ESG, so you can have the environmental score from the Thomson. So they have that one. If you go to the Thomson Reuters for Initiative, they have a ESG, heading. From that, you can get the ESG score as a whole. And not only that, you can also have environmental score. You have also social score, individual scores. And then this is actually another from the, where they define the environmental, climate change, natural resources, pollution and waste, environmental opportunity. This is actually from the MSCI punya rating provider. And the last very famous one, we have a Bloomberg. Okay, Bloomberg is actually they define environment into six things, which is actually carbon emissions, climate change effect, pollutions, waste disposal, renewable energy and resource depletion. So as you can see that again, if you're interested to do conduct on study on the ESG, you may find the ESG score from the Bloomberg, because they actually doing some research and they come up with their own score. That's why this is actually how they define the environmental pillars. Okay, now we move to the next one, which is the social. Okay, when we talk about the social pillar, so what you can see that from the Thomson Reuters, it consists of the components of workforce, human rights, community, and product responsibility. So this is actually from the Thomson Reuters punya rating of social score. And then we have also MSCI. We are talking about four elements, which is human capital, product, liability, stakeholder, and the last one is actually on the okay. Again, Bloomberg tend to have a quite detail or more dimensions on the social, not only on the social as well as on the environmental just now. So the Bloomberg have included the supply chain, discrimination, political diversity. And so we need to say that if the company get involved in all this activity, they will calculate the score for that. So these are the angles of the area they're looking at when they're talking about the social factors or social pillars. Okay, now we move to the governance. Okay, when we talk about governance here, so basically the governance here is the last components for the ESG. Okay, we have from the Thomson, they have classified into three things, which is actually on the management, shareholders, and CSR, corporate social responsibility strategy. So this is actually how the Thomson is actually defined the governance, and how they calculate the governance score. And then when we talk about the MSCI, it consists of two things, which is corporate governance and corporate behavior. And the last part will be Bloomberg. Okay, again, Bloomberg tend to have a very large dimension or items that to be included in governance score. They have the cumulative voting, they have executive compensation that is looking from the management perspective, and then they have a shareholders right, takeover defense, tech led board, and independent director. Okay, not to say that this is the only three rating program. They have a lot now. In fact, there's a quite more than 90 organizations involving trying to get to provide the ESG criteria or ESG scores. But this is actually the three famous one in global. Okay, now we move to the next one. Okay, if you have any question, I think you may write on in the chat, or maybe in the I don't see it from the YouTube. Okay, why is it, why ESG, why people are very moving towards ESG? So here what you can see here is actually, okay, as I mentioned earlier, ESG is not looking from the financial performance. It also consider on the non-financial performance. Okay, when we talk about non-financial, that is actually consists of the three components just now: environmental, socials, and governance. So meaning to say that previously, when people go for investment, they tend to look at the financial ratio in terms of how's the profitable of the company. Are they giving a very good return or not in terms of return or equity, EPS, DPS, all those things, right? So that is more on the financial performance. But now, as I mentioned earlier, we are not only looking at the traditional punya method, which is on the financial performance. We are also considering taking into account the non-financial performance. So this is actually why ESG is needed here, because of elements of non-financial performance that coming from the three indicators just now: environmental, social, and governance. Because at the end of the day, we can see that these particular informations or elements have a direct impact on the company financial performance. And in fact, there are about 90 studies being done showing that there was from why we, yes, because they give a lower cost of capital. Okay, this is talking about the cost of financing lah, from the equity or debt financings. And then we have the 88 studies from previous study have shown that try to have a better operational performance. Okay, when we talk about better operational performance here, it can be in terms of the efficiency, or it can be efficiency performance, it can be financial performance, because it's very broad. And in fact, there's a lot of studies have done on the ESG and environmental social governance and the financial performance. And again, they also they have a better stock price performance. Again, there is 88% realize that when the company get involved with the ESG or participate in environmental, social, and governance, they tend to have better stock price performance. Okay, I've read one study from Halima 2020. What this study is actually, they are comparing the looking at the Malaysians and Indonesians company. But that study was only focusing on 2019. So they try to see what are the factors that influence the stock price performance. And it shows that ESG, and one of the independent variables for that study was like, they have ESG, they have book value, they have size. But that particular study have proved that the ESG element have ESG factors or criteria have an impact, a positive impact to the stock price performance for the Malaysians and Indonesians. But that study only covered on 2019. And then, okay, so that is actually why we have ESG. Okay. I'm so sorry. Okay, and then we have the ESG market. Okay, now look at the ESG market coverage itself. That is globally. So what we have here is actually, okay, we have the world here, the United States. Okay, here is actually, okay, again, the score ESG can come from as low as zero. It can come, the highest one is 100. So this is actually from the component just now that we have gone through. So meaning to say that all the rating provider, they will come up the score based on the criteria and how the company get participate on all these three elements. So from that criteria, they will come up with the three three range. They can have a top 20%, those that get top 20% ESG, and it can be the 0 to 80%, and you got none. Okay, if you look at here, is actually the green, the world one. Okay. Here is the blue one was not, and it has been to see that company does not get involved with the environmental social governance practice. So this one is globally was about 20%. But if you can see that US market is about less than 5%. I would say that about 5% only does not consider the ESG. Meaning to say that most of them is already participate in the, and that's why we can see just now from the global market, there was a very tremendous growth from the US market from 2012 to 2018 just now. And then we have also European country market. There is only about 10% does not consider ESG India. I mean, does not participate in ESG practice. And Japan itself was like 15%. So this is actually in terms of, but when you look at the green one, which is actually 0 to 80% ESG, okay, we can see that the portions for that was quite very big. So meaning to say about 80% of the global market is already, company has already participate on the ESG. That's nearly because the portion of them was very bigger for the world, United States, as well European. And so this is actually, that's why just now when we look at the 3 years growth, you can see that the more company are now considering the non-financial information, which is ESG, in terms of in order to attract more investors to go and invest in their company. And again, when we look at the top 20 ESG here, what we can see that United States shows the one that having a higher, bigger for the top 20 ESGs, and then we'll follow by European and US tend to have a very same portion of the top 20% ESG. And Japan also, again, the range or the proportion trying to getting bigger and bigger because of that, meaning to say that this company are now, they tend to have a very good ESG practice. Okay, now we move to the next one. Okay, the next graph, it will be, okay, this one is actually on the looking at the, okay, this is actually I'm taking from the source of Refinity OSE. Okay, as you can see, they're trying to show the share of market coverage scoring company by region, okay, from the 2013-2019. Okay, the blue color one is the world. So the world was like the increment was slightly, but as you can see here, what happened is that the United States was like very tremendous growth in terms of people are getting more and more ESG parties, and again they will push them ESG score for each of the company. And then we have European Union, European market, and we have Japan here. So this is actually, as you can see, there was like very high, very tremendous growth for the US market. Not so on the European, but US was like very jump, very fast, starting from 2019. So this shows that people are now, more company get attracted to get involved with this ESG environmental and social. And as okay, because they know that at the end of the day, you can see just now, that particular stock can gain more and more in terms of financial performance, ROE, stock price. And not only that, from the lower cost of capital, which is actually from the cost of financing. Okay. Okay, now in global punya performance. Okay, again, I'll try to show you in terms of the, okay, what you can see that, okay, as okay, this is one of the rating provider. Can just now we have Thomson, we have Reuters, we have Thomson Reuters, we have MSCI, and we have Bloomberg. But here we are, I'm just sharing on the, they are trying to compare the world ESG the ESG performer from the MSCI. So from the MSCI, they have the yellow color one is actually, can you see or not? I'm not too sure whether the graph is, can you see sharply or not? I hope the graph can, okay, I hope you can see it. Wait, let me try to, that's much better. Okay, as you can see, this is from the JP Morgan Investment Bank. So they have do a study on the MSCI performance towards the, so from the MSCI, they have a world governance quality, the green color one, and then we have the blue one, which is on the ESG leader. So we need to say this particular company are actually really aggressively involved with the environmental, social, and governance, and with well. So basically, you can see that they go parallel, and they actually doing that upward trends performance on that particular things. And then when we look at the in terms of the sustainable investors asset, again, when we look at the Europe market, there was a growth, because this graph is trying to show from the 2016-2018. So when we look at the Europe, again, there was about 8% annual growth or compound growth for the sustainable invested assets. And not only that, again, as I mentioned, the US market was showing very double growth as compared to Europe, because it was about 17% growth from 16 to 18. And impressively, what we have is actually Japan, because Japan is actually they are actually really really concentrate on the try to go and towards on the ESG. And again, the investors may invested asset is actually jump from very about 114%. And same with Canada, which is actually slightly not so much as like Japan, because Japan was like 100, more than 100%. Canada and Australia, it was about 26% and 19%. So this is actually trying to look at the from the global ESG assets. Okay. Now we move to the share of the global. Okay. This is actually okay. Because just now, this one, I'm so sorry. I don't think that you can see clearly. Okay, basically, these are the countries that they have trying to make some peers comparisons. Okay, the one that vertical one is actually on the ESG, the average ESG score. So basically, they start with South Africa. They already have the Saudi Arabia. Okay, I think the Malaysian one is the one that, okay, but the Indonesian one is this one. So what they have in this graph is actually, okay, they have the first one is environmental pillar. Okay, how many need to see that companies that get okay the environmental score towards the Malaysian company and other company. So if you can see here, actually the green, the first one is environmental score from the Emerson side. And then we have the second one is actually social, and the green one is actually showing the governance. So governance is actually trying to show a very highest governance score. So, and then we have a ESG rating. So this ESG rating means overall lah. So as you can see here is, okay, Malaysia here. So they, from the three element, it looks that the governance score is tend to be higher score. And in fact, from my study itself, I found that about 50%, more than 53% is actually from coming for the average score for the governance score from the Malaysia. So that is okay. This is the one. And when we look at Indonesia here is actually, this is the one right after Mexico. So again, as you can see that the green color, which is actually represent the governance pillar, they tend to have a higher governance score, which means that most of the company are now, they have put in more efforts or more engagement in governance that push the government score to be higher score. And then when we look at the patterns of the Indonesia and Malaysia, it goes the same. The first one was a governance score, and it was followed by the social score, and then was for environment, meaning that we are quite behind for the environmental score here, because from my study itself, it looks that less than 50% company are get involved or get participate with environmental issues, especially in terms of transportation. We still have in Malaysia, for example, that is quite rare to find an electric car, because we are not moving toward that. If you look at Paris Agreement itself, they will try move away from that. But we, when we look at environment issue, we are quite low, because we're not even reaching 50% punya score. So this is actually Indonesians, the one that I met. Okay. So basically, the red color here is actually represent the Malaysia. But this one is actually Indonesian. So more or less, it goes the same things, okay? And in fact, from the Malaysian perspective, we started with the sustainability reporting, whereby we encouraged, started in 2014. And it become a compulsory or mandatory starting 2018. But for the Indonesians one, what happened is that from my research, it looks that they're still in voluntarily, but now they are moving towards, I think after 2020, which is now moving to require all those company to go and participate and disclose. They got to disclose the environmental, because not many companies disclose on the environmental, social and governance factors. So that one is talking about the ESG disclosure. Okay. Okay, let's move to the next one. Wait a minute. Wait, Okay. This is global comparisons. Okay, now look at the Asian regions. Okay, Asian region here, we are talking about the, the Asian region, wait a minute. Okay, the Asian region here, basically here, they got countries of Thailand, Singapore, Malaysia, Indonesia, Vietnam. Okay, and in fact, we have ESG performance that call it FTSE 4 Good Asian Index. Okay, they actually covering, company coming from the six countries, which is Thailand, Singapore, Malaysia, Philippines, Indonesia. But now, from the latest one, they only include the Vietnam on that thing. Because previously, we only have about 5 FTSE 4 Good Asian Index. So if you look at here, they got the yellow color, he's talking about unmanaged ESG risk. And this is the ESG risk, and the management score. So basically, we are more interested on the score of that particular, because this is talking about the ESG. Because the one, potential future, we are not also concerned about ESG, but I'm not talking about ESG risk today, because I'm more concerned on the ESG factors or ESG stocks rather than on the ESG risk. So basically, if you look at the management score here, what you can see here is that, if you look at this one, Malaysia, previously, Malaysia was the first one in the Asia, but now Malaysia dropped into number two, because the first one now is Thailand. So Thailand is actually now, they are encouraging more on towards the sustainable investing or ESG investing. Then we go, we actually number two, and then it was followed by the Singapore. Singapore is quite higher than okay, number one was Thailand in the Asian region, and second one was Malaysians, and then we have the third one is actually Singapore, and the fourth one is actually Philippines and Indonesia. So Philippines, I think Philippines is much a bit higher from Indonesia. So Indonesia is, as I mentioned, because they still not they not put it as mandatory for the corporation over there. So they just started mandatory after 2020, because what they only require what they did is actually more by the voluntary disclosure. So that's why the one that he for the Indonesian market, what they do is actually they more putting mandatory only for the banking sectors, but not for all the companies. So that's why you can see that the ESG cost is quite lower, and in fact was fall under number fifth lah. And then there will be again, Vietnam pun just joined. I think previously when I do, it was no Vietnam. So that's why Vietnam tend to be the quite low punya ESG score lah, management score. So this is actually in terms of formant of Asian regions. Okay. Let us look at the key Malaysia. Okay, Malaysia. Okay, when they started the it started with the corporate social responsibility actually. So earlier, when you can see more people are doing CSR, corporate social responsibility studies. So how's the company? And then they're moving to the social responsible investments. So basically, they try to look at the social responsible investment. What are people? Okay, so in a way, but along the way, that element have been improved until they come up with the environment, sustainable investing, or maybe we were more proper to say ESG investing. Because and that particular what they have, they are considering three elements, not only social responsibility, they only can see of environmental, social, and governance. So what you can hear is that from that angles, they have come out, the FTSE have come out with the index that is cater for the ESG performance. So that's why in Malaysia, we have FTSE 4 Good Index. And this FTSE Good Index is actually, as you can see that, this is actually been introduced in December 2014. Okay, because this index was created by FTSE, so they realized that we have the ESG, we have already encouraged how to see the performance. So that's why they come up with the index. And again, that index is actually coming from when they started, it was only 24 company. So that's why if you look at the some ideas of FTSE for Good Index or the ESG index, it was actually introduced in December 2014. With a good ESG practice that aligns with the leading ESG framework such as GRI. So GRI is actually the Global Reporting Initiative and Carbon Disclosure Project. So meaning to say that for you to see whether ESG is doing well or not. So that's why FTSE have taken some initiative. So what they did is actually they come up with the index called FTSE for Good Index. So FTSE for Good Bursa Malaysia Index. And this one, FTSE Malaysia Index, is actually measuring the performance of public listed company that demonstrates strong environmental, social, and governance, which means that this particular company that constitute our FTSE for Good name, they are really, really perform a very good ESG practice. So that makes them consider under this one. And when they started this index, they started with 24 company only. And then now they are, I think based on last year punya, December, it was 75 company. And in fact, along the way, from this 75 company is actually coming from the because in Malaysia, we have about 900 plus public listed company. From that, 75% is actually showing a very good ESG, and that things was being included in the FTSE for Good Malaysia Index. So this is actually worldwide in Malaysia market. Okay, now we look at Sakib. And in fact, along the way, they got some company, contohnya macam Top Glove. Okay, they used to be in the FTSE for Good Index, but now they will be delisted from that because they're not they preach one of the pillars on that, especially on the social factors lah, whereby they have some against on that. So that is actually why they get not necessarily that they can be all the time. So if they preach one of the elements, they can get out from that FTSE for Good Index. Okay, the full FTSE Good Index is considered drawn from a company, Bursa Malaysia Index. Okay, where does this index come from? Okay, we know that in Malaysia we have advanced index, we have small medium, kan? So if you look at the number of Malaysian company in FTSE Good Malaysia Index name, from the mid market there was mid 70, they had about 33 companies, and then from the FEBM KLCI index they had 23 company, and then from the FPI small they have 70. So this one is actually giving you that just now about 73, because I think this is actually the 75 is actually the latest one. But this is actually early 2020. So the number of those that in the FTSE index is not as much as the one that in the and most I've realized that from my observation or from my research itself, it's about in Malaysia, if I'm not mistaken, is about 10 company coming from the financial sectors, which is from the banks. Okay, this is the one. Okay, now we try to look at the comparative performance of ESG stock. Okay, we have here is actually S&P 500. Yes, okay. Yes, Standard & Poor 500 and versus Standard. So this is actually, they're trying to make a comparison whether those who involve ESG, how they perform, and those who, okay, that's why this is from the S&P, Standard & Poor, from the US market. So you can see what happened is that, so the red color, the orange color is S&P 500 ESG. This is from the ESG indicator lah, performance. So then there will be, okay, as you can see that first year, okay, you had the, here they do some comparison on 10-year punya period, 5 years, 3 years, and 1 year. So what happened is that the ESG is really outperformed. And in fact, because you know that the S&P 500 is normal index lah, not considering the ESG. So you can see that along the way, 10 year, 5 year, what you can see that there was a very outperform for the ESG. So this is a very positive indicator showing that future prospect for ESG is very positive, because when they do comparison in S&P itself, it looks that they are really perform from 0.1 in 10 year, become 0.6 until that 2.3 in 1 year period. So that is from the global market itself. Okay, what about in Malaysia itself? So from the Malaysia itself, where we can see here is, they are trying to compare the good for ESG index, which is for FTSE for Good Malaysia and FBM biasa lah index. So what happened is that when you look at that, you can see that the yellow color one is actually for the ESG, because that's FTSE for Good, and the one is actually the normal index. So in the first part, you nampak for there was a very annual return was slightly higher for the mask. But along the way, what you can see that because at that time I believe that there was like when they just started, because when you say 5 years, because now kita started pun 2000, because now we're in 2021. So because we know that just now the index started in 2014. So I believe at this time it was about 2016 or 15, whereby we still quite new on for ESG. So that's why there was. But even though it was really reaching quite near to the FPM mask. And then when we look at the performance was not so good in Malaysia, because you can see that there was negative 0.4, not like S&P. Yeah, okay. Again, this is actually comparison. It was standing, and then it was like 1 year. This is because of the COVID itself. Like 1 year, because this is 2020, 1920. So most of us get affected, and not only for the normal index, but also for the FTSE for the ESG index. So there was a drop of negative 2.4. The ESG of not really outperform like you as compared to the global market. Okay, let us look on the that is actually giving some ideas on how the performance of the global and the for the emas. Okay, in fact, I'm not okay, as we do have also the Asian, that FTSE for Good Asian index. That cover, but I'm so sorry, but I'm not managed to get the the performance mini chart for that, because that one you can see for Asian index they just started for nearly about 2 years, because they started in 2018, not like this one is actually 2014 for the Malaysian one. Okay, now we come to what are the sustainable strategies here. Okay, the sustainable investments. Okay, we know that traditionally, people, when they do investment decision, is more by the traditional financial factor. Meaning to select, they try to look at the market ratios. They try to look at the financial ratios, right? Financial factor, that's how the investment decision work. But nowadays, people are not looking at the investors, as retail investors, industry, they're not only looking at the financial factors, but they are considering whether these particular company, are they really involved or not in the environmental, social and governance factor. That's why investment decision now is a three-way thought. They are trying to look at both sides, financial factors and non-financial factor, that is ESG. So what are the strategy investor must take to invest sustainably? So basically, they've got four common strategy here. Okay, we have negative exclusion screening, we have positive screening, we have ESG integration, we have sustainability team investing. Okay, let's have a look at the first one. Okay, the first one is actually, we are talking about the negative strategies here. Okay, the negative strategy or exclusion strategy here. So what they do is the investor will exclude company that company from investment, meaning that in their portfolio, they try to look, they try to a company that having some on the company on the weapons. Because weapon we know is actually is a not okay. When we say negative, whoever company that get involved with weapons or in terms of the clear record of human rights violation, they try to take away. Okay, one good example yang human right ni, Top Glove ni is actually being excluded from the FTSE. Initially, Top Glove was included, but because of the breach that violations, so they was being taken away from the FTSE. And again, the negative strategy is actually they try to look at it. They try to exclude company yang involved dengan weapons as well on the human right violations. That is on the negative screening strategies. Okay, now we have a positive screening. So in this one, investor include sector that project invest in class. Okay, what I mean by in class, they try to look at the company that having higher ESG score. We need to see that the range of ESG score, it can be low as zero. It could be that zero means that company to langsung tak get involved with environmental ke, social ke, or governance. If you're talking about overall punya lah. Tapi the highest can come also 100%. But so far, I don't see 100%. But I can see that from my investment, it was like 90-80% lah at the ESG score, but not so many. So that's why here is actually they try to look at, they're looking for a company with current high ESG score, and probably those have been improving their ESG score. I mean, to see that, okay, kalau you pergi dekat Thomson, the writers kan, you can see that how's the performance of ESG score, whether is it going improving. So in a way that the positive screening, as an investor, what I do is I try to look at the ESG score for those here. From time to time, if I look at the ESG is improving from time, so that is actually one of the under the issues that I'm in the positive screen, because I'm really concerned about the current high screening score ataupun improvement of the ESG score. So one good example what can see here is investing in upstream oil anchors company that beat the peer in ESG despite the broader in less than Africa. This is actually the positive screening strategies. And then we have the next one, which is on ESG integrations. Okay, ESG integration, what I have to do is this strategy is trying to proactively include the ESG factors into financial to identify the risk. Meaning to say that they try to combine the financial analysis and the ESG to measure the risk, to identify the risk and the risk. That's why we, again, nowadays people, last time people are talking about the ESG, but now people are talking about climate risk, investment, what you call that, ESG risk. So these are all the things that climate risk, environmental risk, this is moving forward, because we know that, okay, these are the retail. Okay, what about in terms of the risk? So that's why they try to identify on this, they try to identify the risk and opportunity when investing in company. So we need to see that, because again, at the end of the day, they don't want to have make sure that their return is actually, because they try to have very good positive and considering the risk also lower. So that's why now, very good, if you wanted to do, I believe that people now moving to study on ESG's risk. Because risk is actually one of the components when you talk about the portfolio returns ataupun what you call the asset return. The risk is one of acting elements that you got to into consideration. And the last one is actually sustainable team investors. Okay, this one involves investing in company or sector that relate to sustainable, such as investing in fund that focus on renewable energy and sustainable agriculture practice. So these are the common sustainability strategy that we've done. Okay, now we move to okay, this is actually trying to show what is, okay, we have here, okay, avoid that, okay, we have here, okay, here first one is exclusion screen, slight negative screening. So what they're trying to look is actually they are trying to look at the investor Okay, that's why I say, especially screening, when we okay, that's why when we talk about sustainable investing, it's more pada SRR. Common term, you can see the SR. Some of the authors or ataupun previous study, they would say, social. Okay, what is SR? SR is social responsible investment. So this started with social responsible investment. So now people are moving towards ESG lah. So what they do is actually they will look at the company is more familiar at that time, especially they try to like social responsible investment, meaning to say that they try to exclude company industry yang ada fossil fuel lah. Okay, now people are not fossil country ni kan. Fossil country mana? Fossil ni kan minyak, fuel. So kita now we try to get people going for the transport zero carbon emission. Sebab kita tak nak people too much on that. So that's why here is actually whoever company tu kalau dia exclude industri yang fossil fuel ataupun country yang one good example Sudan lah. And then they have a catholic value. Okay, this is more pada religious lah, macam we have in Islamic we have a Sharia compliant. But in Catholic also they have a screening out on the weapons, tobacco, gambling. So this is like macam yang Sharia compliance but on the religious matter lah. Macam kita kalau when we say Sharia compliance stock in Malaysia, we are talking about company that they have they don't have involved in pork, non-alcohol, what you call that, entertainment, riba, tobacco, all this. So this is like okay, but in this one is actually these are more pada Catholic value. So this is actually for the exclusionary screening. But now we are talking about the ESG screening investing. Okay, again when we look at this is actually how the what you call that, the movement from the exclusive until that by the ESG investing and the impact investing. Okay, the second one is actually on the ESG investings. So what we can see is actually they try to look at company that having ESG policy and practice, and not only that, they are also considering all these things in their investment percent. Okay, one thing what they got to do is invest in company with higher ESG score. That's why I said tadi, you not talk, okay, now investor ni very smart. They not go and invest, they what they do is they look at the high ESG. And in fact, now we have ESG score. Because we look just now, we can get ESG score from the Thomson Reuters. We can also look at the ESG score from the from the MSCI. We can look at the ESG from the Bloomberg. This is actually the top three lah. You can from that as an investor, I can have a look on that, okay? And one thing also, what can I do is I can also look from the index. Now we have index. Kat Malaysia, we have a full index. So that from that, you can show how the performance of the ESG stock. Okay, but Indonesians, sadly, Indonesia, they don't have single index for the ESG. So they only have the ESG one rating dekat dalam FTSE for good Asian index. Yang tu untuk Asians lah, region. Then they overweight portfolio with company that have low carbon for need. So this is actually on the ESG investing. But impact investing pula, investing with intention to get a beneficial measurement, beneficial social and environmental along with Fajr. Maknanya dia nak ada impact pada not only pada financial but pada environmental impact and social impact. Tadi kita, so what is actually impact investing is they try to get target positive impact on the environment by buying green bond. That's why nowadays you can see that most of the company when they wanted to raise a capital, they were for issuing a green bond, a green suku. So that is actually they moving towards the ESG punya asset lah. Because they are now, they know that okay, we should consider all these things. And then in fact, in Malaysia, we quite, when we talk about financing side from the bank itself, is quite low. The bank is supporting on the buying of green vehicles. That's why green vehicle punya, in Malaysia, when we see green vehicle ni, electric vehicle lah, basically is quite low lah. And then we have the invest in company with high quality, local health tool. Okay, this is actually on the, okay, we wanted to see that from the impact investing, invest in company that have high quality, low cost health care, and low income population effect. So this is actually our target moving towards on it. So this is actually on the strategies. Okay, now we go to the, okay, this is actually from the studies by, okay, this is actually a survey being done on that. Okay, on the which we are global investment strategy. So they are doing a comparison 2016 and 18 from the global perspective. So what are the strategies here? They have a corporate engagement and shareholder sections. We have ESG integration. We have impact investing, which is impact is basically named as community investing. We have negative, no, okay. These are all the strategy. And again, from that, they can see that how many percent growth actually happened from 2016 to 18. So what happened is that if you look at here, the first one was in sustainability team investing. Sustainability ni, part of that is actually they're considering all the whether the company can give a positive impact, financial factor as well as non-financial factors lah. And then we have also positive screening, 125%. And for the ESG, kalau dia hanya integrate saja on growth dia sikit. Tapi kalau dia betul-betul emphasize on it, it was to end. And the lowest was on the corporate engagement. So this, and in fact, there was no growth for the non-based screening. So this is a comparison between 2016 and 18 from the angle of sustainable investing strategies. Okay, we are coming to the end, I guess. Okay, we are actually, okay, what was the future prospects of ESG? So as you can see here is that the ESG investing is a very positive, okay, when you look at the performance of FTSE, when you look at MSCI Good Index, we can see that ESG is showing a positive indicator in the global market. And again, what we can see that one of the way of now people invest, ESG is one of the approach whereby investors are using it to support their good company. Meaning to say, in order for them to invest, what the company do, they will see what is the ESG score. Because you can see the environment, social score as overall. But again, you boleh tengok juga environment score per se individually. So you as an investor have a right on that. Okay, where you want to get it, you can get from the Thomson Reuters, you can get from the Reuters, the Bloomberg punya provider, you can get from the MSCI. So from that, you can identify which are the company a company really good and participate in the ESG. And from that, you can also invest them in financial strong prospect. So this is the key. And again, when you look at global one, globally, what you can see that the global sustainable fund asset have reached about 2.25 trillion. This is based on the June 2021 lah. And there was a report by Morningstar Direct. The global ESG fund asset increased to 2.5 trillion from 1.65. Nampak? In 1 year time, there was a very quite increment dalam 1.65 pada 2.25, and there was so kalau you tengok the it was like 128 to 168 and then 2.24. There was a very good increment from the global punya ESG fund asset. And then when earlier I've mentioned already, the things that you can see that from the European country pun, there was a very high quite tremendous growth on that. Not as much as US lah. So as June 2020, Europe company had the higher number of ESG fund. So which is about 76%, followed by US market. So this is in terms of ESG funds. And then the last part will be, okay, what about, according to the global initiative for sustainable rating, well above 100% regulated produce sustainable rating. So this is actually, okay, now, as I mentioned, just now I was showing about 3% rating get from MSCI FTSE, how did I mention, right? But now you can see that from the global initiative sustainable rating, there are more and more organizations are trying to produce sustainable rating. Maksudnya, there are more company to evaluate or to measure the environmental and social and governance score. So not only these companies, there are about 100 now. They are doing some collections of them where the company participate and then they come up with their own score. Lah. Again, they have their own parameter. Because tadi, what we did is actually now we just look at three parameter defined for the environmental, social and governance. Okay. And again, we can see that improvement in energy will require a greater global engagement among the market player. Lah. And we are very lucky in Malaysia because we have a sustainability reporting framework. And then when we talk about sustainability, basically they try to disclose what the company have done on environmental, social and governance. So we have, we've not mistaken, sustainability reporting in Malaysia started in 2016 or 17. Okay, and then that is actually trying to help the shape the ESG. At the end of the day, we try to encourage more company to get participate in environmental, social. Because at the end of the day, we as an investor, doesn't matter we are retail investor, we are institutional investor. Now we are very concerned on the non-financial indicator, which is ESG. We wanted to see whether company that we invested, we which is just to, are they really get involved on ESG? So the ESG score needs to become one of the element that the investor will look at, not only the financial ratios or financial indicator ataupun, but they will look at the ESG score as part of their investment strategy. And as you can see that a Morgan Stanley 2019 found that 85 individual investor are interested. Nampak? From the US market, it said they proved that 85 individual investor and 35% are more interested on sustainability. So when we see sustainability investing, we are talking about the company that practicing the environmental, social and governance factors or practice. Okay, and the last one, what you can see that for the from the prospect from the sustainable investor itself. So what we can see that, okay, strong investment potential if the company having a higher ESG score. So we need to say when ESG scores ni maknanya, you can look from the environmental score, social score and government score. So this is actually, this is showing the, an optimal space for the sustainable investor. Maknanya, you as a sustainable investor, you not only you are really concerned where what where your money go, and your money go must be your money that you go to that company you that you injected the, or you invested in that company must currently really concerns on the environmental issues, social issue and governance governance issues. So that is all from me. I think I've okay. Thank you. Any questions? I hope you understand what my speech is all about. It's something to do with a new phenomena on ESG stocks.
Okay, thank you to Dr. Nor Ashiki binti Ismail for the talk. Ladies and gentlemen, before we end our first session, we open up for Q&A session. Madam, there is one question that said that what are the main challenges to ESG investing?
What are the main challenges in ESG?
Investing.
Okay, because as you can see that from the graph itself, I mean from the observation itself, they got some of the company who actually still does not considering the ESG is one of the elements for indicator for the shareholders. So because if you look at the graph that I'm showing just now, ESG score, you can see that environment score is still quite low. And again, in from the perspective of Malaysia punya pun, not all company are really get involved putting it as a what you call it a very important elements. Kalau you tengok, kalau yang sekarang yang I nampak yang banyak yang get involved is more pada finance company lah, banking sectors. So again, they will be they need to get participation from the regulator itself to support in terms of the regulator part. We can see there's a sustainable development goal punya map, tapi daripada segi for the side of the investor itself, they still go for the what you call, they still considering that financial indicator rather than not many people are aware of ESG. That is one of the challenge, because I'm sure that if you, some of you say what is ESG, and even some of the people might not know what is FTSE4Good index, because they know that they know the normal index, but they, so there was like a lack of awareness juga lah dalam ESG ni. Walaupun we have a very good plan on the sustainable responsible investment plan. And I hope I am answering on that.
Madam, before we move to second question, can you stop presenting?
Okay, sure. Sorry. Sorry.
Okay, madam, second question. Is it a good idea to invest in ESG stock after the pandemic?
Yeah. Because nowadays, as you can see that even though there was a drop in 1 year last year, but doesn't mean that ESG stock is not good. Because at the end of the day, in global market itself, you can see there was a very tremendous growth. So I believe because ESG stock can perform much, much better than other index, other stocks. So because pandemic at that time, it was like macam when you talk about COVID time, most of the stock market was not doing, I mean, not operated. So that's why it was a drop. So that one cannot be as indicator for that. But there's a very good prospect for the ESG stock, because they are considering all this element. And this element is very, very important, because they are catering for all the stakeholders, not only for the shareholders. you're talking about the community, you are talking about the human right, you are talking about the board of directors. So you are actually a very very broad punya what you call that stakeholders. I hope I'm answering that particular. Okay, what else?
Okay, so any other question? Okay, so if there's no other question, we will end the first slot.
Okay, thank you.
Attention to all, we will start our next session at 3 p.m. Thank you and Assalamualaikum.
Waalaikumsalam.